Hello, good evening. Thank you very much for attending. It's lovely to see such a large crowd for this evening's lecture. Just to introduce myself very briefly, my name is Rachel Robbins. I'm one of the lecturers here in Central America at Manchester Metropolitan University. There's a couple of announcements I have to make before. Can people hear me?
Yes.
Sorry, I have only got a little voice, so do apologise. A couple of announcements I have to make before the main event. The first one is that at the end of the session, please come and sign a petition against G4S and against the degradation of our public services. And also to let you know that there is an event held at the Friends Meeting House on Thursday the 19th of March at 7 p.m. about boycotting Israeli goods and the general election hustings. And that's a chance to bring up Palestine Solidarity Campaign. But my big announcement before we go to the main event is that to say that after much persuasion and time, Manchester Metropolitan University have finally agreed to have a permanent marker to the courage of Tom Hurndall. And for that reason, we held over the last year a student competition to design the memorial. And that's what you can see on screen behind you. Just to let you know that that memorial will also include Tom Hurndall's name, his dates of his unfortunately short life, and that he was killed by the Israeli Defence Force. The winner and the very amazing artist who produced that design is Aira Kaplan, and I'd just like to present her with a certificate to say thank you for her hard work. To introducing our speaker, Rania Masri. Rania Masri is a social justice and anti-war activist. Writings and activism have centred on the occupation of Palestine and the struggle against the apartheid and racism of the Israeli state. She has also written and organised extensively against the sanctions on Iraq and for civil and environmental rights. She has worked as an environmental science professor and chair of the Department of Environmental Sciences at the University of Beirut in Lebanon, and as director of the Southern Peace Research and Education Centre at the Institution for Southern Studies in North Carolina in the US. Currently, she is the associate director of the Isfari Institute for Civil Society and Citizenship at the American University of Beirut. She also serves on the advisory board of the Palestinian Campaign for the Academic and Cultural Boycott of Israel. I think we're incredibly proud to have her here. She'll be speaking, and has assured me she will take questions on anything at the end of this meeting.
Well, it really is my honour to be with you and to commemorate one of our heroes and one of our courageous souls. Thank you very much. And you made it sound like a challenge. I will answer any question you pose, so let's see what kind of questions will come up. You know, it's always a challenge to figure out how to talk about Palestine and where to begin and what can best represent what Palestinians have been going through since the early 40s. And I recently came across a story that really does represent what we have been going through. Abed Qutqut is a simple Palestinian man. He had lived his entire life in a refugee camp, in the Hesha refugee camp in the West Bank. And he decided to leave the refugee camp and to try to settle in a piece of land he had inherited from his family. And that piece of land he had inherited overlooked his original village that he was exiled from back in 1948. Now, this piece of land that the Israelis acknowledge is his, rightfully, inherited by, you know, left to him by his family, happens to fall under the Israeli Jerusalem municipality. And this Israeli Jerusalem municipality is also an occupied entity, it's an occupied political entity on an occupied land. But they declare that he actually cannot alter any aspect of this land because it falls under their jurisdiction. And so he decided to actually live in a cave. and within this cave to set up little, you know, electricity outages. He set up a little outdoor toilet. He couldn't bring in, build a water well, so we actually had to transport water by gallons. And he fought the Israeli courts for his right to remain and to build somewhat of a home in this cave. After more than 10 years in the courts, and after the Jerusalem municipality itself began developing the area illegally, because this is defined as occupied land, and they developed the area by establishing a park, the government further announced another Jewish-only settlement expansion. And the verdict came out. The verdict was that Abbott could stay in the cave, but that he could not alter the land. Altering the land only fell to the Israeli government. So in other words, he could stay in the cave, but he could not get water, he could not get electricity, he could not get safe passage. They destroyed everything he had built. He built it again. They destroyed it again. He ended up dying at the age of 54 from a broken heart. The court verdict stated Abbott could stay in a cave. And I find that to be very symbolic of what the Israeli courts have been stating that all Palestinians can do. We can only live in caves. Earlier in the month of February, in early February, Prime Minister Netanyahu announced the destruction of 400 Palestinian homes in Area C, so-called Area C in the occupied West Bank. Area C encompasses 60% of the West Bank, and it is fully under the control of the Israeli occupying army. Now, the remaining Area A and Area B in the West Bank are also under the control of the Israeli army, but they're presented as under the facade of the control of the Palestinian Authority, while Area C is fully only under the control of the Israeli army. So Netanyahu has ordered the destruction of 400 more homes. And there's 20,000 Palestinian homes in Jerusalem that are set to be demolished. 20,000 Palestinian homes in Jerusalem. Since 1967, at least 27,000 Palestinian homes in the occupied West Bank alone have been demolished. And these are according to Israeli records. And the way Israel defines a home is any structure. So even if that structure is an apartment building, it defines it as one home. So again, this is an understatement when we say 27,000 Palestinian homes. And we know what happened in Gaza last summer. After years and years and years of an illegal criminal blockade, it's not a siege, because the difference between a siege and a blockade is once it is militarily enforced, it becomes a blockade. So after years of a completely destructive, suffocating blockade, after several wars imposed on the Palestinians in Gaza every 2 years, the Israelis launched another massacre on Gaza last summer, 51 days of assault, in which more than 100,000 homes were damaged. More than 100,000 homes were damaged. And barely anything has been rebuilt. 6 months after the last bomb on Gaza, barely anything has been rebuilt, not one single large project. What we need in Gaza for the rebuilding, not just of this last war, but the earlier wars imposed on Gaza, is at least 1.5 million tons of cement. All that has been let into Gaza because of both the Israeli criminal blockade and, we have to be clear about this, the Egyptian criminal blockade, because the Egyptians are also imposing a blockade, all that has been allowed to enter Gaza is 27,000 tons of cement, and they need 1.5 million tons of cement. 2 weeks ago, 80 additional homes in Gaza were flooded. Water reached 3 meters in height, because not only were the Palestinians in Gaza cursed with significant rain, but the Israelis took this opportunity to actually open several dams and flood the area even more. So as with Abed Qutqut in the West Bank, Palestinians in Gaza can only live in caves, deprived of electricity, which barely functions, deprived of clean water, because the vast majority of water in Gaza is actually not fit for human consumption, and deprived of safe passage. There is no way out. Banksy, who I'm sure many of you have heard of, recently found a way to enter Gaza, and he said that many people compare Gaza to a prison. But he said that's not accurate. Because in prison you do get electricity, and you do get water, and you do get sufficient food, and if you're lucky, you might even get medical care. And if you happen to be in a Swedish prison, then you get so much more. But it's not even a prison. And what's important to recognize is that these home demolitions, these deliberate, continual home demolitions, are not limited to the occupied territory. They're not limited to the West Bank and Jerusalem. They have been ongoing within the state of Israel against Palestinians with Israeli citizenships. With Israeli citizenships. 80,000 Palestinians with Israeli citizenships in the Negev live in communities that the Israeli government finds to be unrecognized. We recognize you and we recognize that we don't recognize you, and thereby we deprive you of electricity and water and sufficient schooling. 80,000 Palestinians. And the Israeli government takes it to another level, because when they do demolish Palestinian homes with Israeli citizenships, they have the chutzpah to actually demand that the Palestinians pay for the demolition of their home. On top of all this, the demolition is not limited to homes, because anything that stands in the way of the Jewish-only expansion of territory in historic Palestine gets destroyed. So a week ago, the Israelis issued demolition orders for a school near El-Khalil in Hebron. A school had to be demolished because they want to expand another 50 square kilometers. And for many of us, not just those of us who are Palestinian, but for many of us who've been following the struggle, we're not surprised. I have yet to be surprised by anything that the Israeli government does, by anything that the Israeli military does. But still, it is a bit surprising to know the vast majority of the Jewish Israeli society are openly in support of discriminatory policies. The vast majority are openly in support. Now, I lived 20 years in the United States, and I'm familiar with policies of racism. But racism has gotten to a stage in the US where people don't say that they're racist. We are racist, but you know, we try to hide behind another veneer. But when you have polls such as this, this was a poll from October 2012, and the numbers have only gotten worse, where you have a clear majority of Jewish Israeli citizens saying that they think the separation of Israeli and Palestinians in roads, because you know we have two different roads, one for Israeli cars, one for Palestinian cars, in the occupied land, is good. 24% plus 50%, that's 74% support separate road systems. Separate road systems. We cannot be on the same road. 69% openly support not just the annexation of the West Bank, but the deprivation of Palestinians in the West Bank of the right to vote were the West Bank to be annexed. And then what gets to be really scary, to me what takes it to a whole other level, is almost half of the Jewish Israelis polled in 2012 openly support the expulsion of Palestinians with Israeli citizenships. This is ethnic cleansing in 2012. That's what it is. You have a citizenship, but I don't like it. This is ethnic cleansing in 2012. So the question becomes, what does it mean when racism becomes so normalized? What does it mean for the actions of the military and the academics and the politicians and society in general when racism becomes so normalized? It means that you have constant closure of villages, towns, and complete areas, detention of men, women, and children for 6 months without charge, and the 6 months can be renewed. All this is acceptable. Expansion of settlements for only one religion, and continually to expand those settlements. Constant theft of people's land, constant theft of people's homes, constant home demolitions, constant bombardment. All of this is ongoing. So what does it mean to the children? Both children, Palestinian and Israelis, when such racism becomes normalized, when such attacks become acceptable daily practice. What does it mean when these homes become demolished The picture of the little girl looking at her home is demolished. By the way, this was a little girl with Israeli citizenship in a majority Arab town in the so-called state of Israel. And the other picture is of a single mother who was given 30 minutes notice before her home was destroyed. And this is ongoing, these home demolitions. Ongoing. In 2005, a Palestinian feminist interviewed Maryam, an 11-year-old little girl, who desperately wanted to speak out as to the trauma she felt when her home was demolished. She described this image. She said, hundreds of police and military officers attacked my home in Silwan. Silwan is on the edge of occupied Jerusalem. She described how big dogs were primed to attack her mother who was holding her younger brother as she tried desperately to protect the home. She described how she was terrorized by the loud noise of the bulldozers to such an extent that now the color yellow frightens her. For an 11-year-old child. She described how she lost the ability to speak and how she has now faced child-onset diabetes because of the trauma. And because she now has diabetes, her mother is afraid that if she continues to speak out, she will be deprived of medical treatment by the Jewish hospitals. But Maryam said something very powerful. She said, and I quote, "House demolitions have become normal. The bulldozers have become something normal for Jews. They have demolished too many homes in Silwan that the demolition of my home is normal, which makes me upset at the world. I feel sick, very sick. I feel exhausted." What catches me is this is an 11-year-old child feeling exhausted by the normalcy. And when I first read those words, I stopped and asked myself, has it become normal for me to read of another home being demolished? Has it become normal for us to read of these continuous attacks? Because they have become quite continuous. But Maryam isn't from this small town east of Jerusalem. Maryam's family is from Haifa. Maryam's family lost their original home in Haifa in 1948. So this spiral of dispossession and theft of land and theft of home began in their family in 1948, and it has been ongoing. And whenever a child or anyone loses their home, they not only lose a place of sanctuary and a place of safety, they lose their items, they lose their memories, and they lose their connection to the individuals and the family members who also lived with them. Their lives become smaller and more cloistered. And this is ongoing. But another crime that has been ongoing is the consistent and increasing detention of children. 2014, according to Defense for Children International, was a very sad time for children in Palestine. 20% of all the children that were detained, by the Israeli military and Israeli police force were placed in solitary confinement. International law defines solitary confinement as torture. 20% of children were placed in solitary confinement. 75% of children faced physical abuse. And what is even more horrific, it's not as if these children were picked up from their home at 4 o'clock in the afternoon with a knock on the door, and a policeman taking them and placing them in a jeep with a lawyer and then isolating them. Now, the Israeli government recently stated very clearly that it will continue its nighttime raids of children's detention. Nighttime raids, which means between midnight and 5 o'clock in the morning, Israeli military and Israeli police force break down the doors, drag the child out of his bed, blindfold him or her, handcuff him or her, throw them in the back of a jeep, and the vast majority get physically assaulted. Children. Khalid Uthman was one of many, 15-year-old, who said that while he was interrogated, they threatened him with sexual abuse. And this threat of sexual abuse, again, is nothing new. It's nothing new. It has only increased. The threat and the act of sexual abuse against Palestinian women has been ongoing since 1948. I'm sure many of you here know about the massacre of Deir Yassin, one of the most famous massacres that happened in 1948 to encourage Palestinians to flee from their homes. What we may not know was that many of these women were also raped in front of their children before they were killed. Back in 1948. Now, many of you may also have heard during the before the bombing of Gaza last summer, when the three Israeli settlers, three Israeli teenagers, were missing, although the Israeli government knew very well where they were, there became this inflamed hatred against Palestinians to such an impact that a professor, Professor Mordechai Kidar of the Begin Sadat Center for Strategic Studies, openly said on public radio, openly said, the only deterrent for those who kidnap the children and kill them, the only way to deter them is their knowledge that either their sister or their mother will be raped if they are caught. That is an open justification and an open call for the rape of women. Open call. And again, the audacity of this and the response to his statements was not a call for him to apologize. The response to his statement was he was promoted academically and promoted by the Israeli government and placed on a list of official spokespersons for journalists. But his comments were not the aberration. His comments were not the exception. If we're familiar with what happened during the assault on Gaza last summer, it was common to hear Jewish-Israeli slogans and Jewish-Israeli protesting and Jewish-Israelis writing with statements such as, and I quote, go pound their mothers and come back to your mother. And the first time I heard this, I actually thought they meant pound as in beat until I realized they weren't referring to physical abuse. They were referring to sexual abuse. Because they also distributed a big sign that they gave to Netanyahu in which they have an image of a veiled woman, naked from the waist down, with a message saying, be finished inside this time. Be finished inside this time. Signed citizens in favor of a ground assault. Open, clear call for rape of women. And as if that were not enough, we see these shirts, and these shirts have become very popular by both Israeli military and Israeli civilians. The one in blue is an image of a pregnant Palestinian woman with a sniper crosshair on her belly with the statement underneath saying, one shot, two kills. You have additional images of targeting children, quote, confirming the kill. Another shirt said that every Arab mother know that her son's fate is in my hands, as the child is targeted in a crosshair, and it goes on. An open call for the targeting of children in these shirts. And what they reflect is how Palestinian women and Palestinian children have become both literal and figurative targets for killing. And what they reflect is the ease with which killing can be dismissed and justify the ease with which certain lives can be set aside. And set aside so openly that there no longer is any shame in doing so. No longer any shame. So it comes as no surprise that these pictures also get distributed, because to me the greatest act of racism is not to see me. When I am unseen, that I find to be the greatest crime. I am not even seen in these images of an Australian tourist posing with the Australian flag and the Israeli flag as a Palestinian in his own town gets humiliated by an occupier. The Palestinian is unseen, rendered invisible. How many other crimes and brutalities and murders are rendered invisible because their lives are so easily dismissed? How many times does the Western media render crimes against Palestinians invisible? Note every time they speak of calm, every time CNN or the New York Times or the Independent or the Guardian speak of calm, they only refer to calm against Israelis, because Palestinians have received no calm since 1948. Palestinian fishermen off the coast of Gaza continue to be attacked. Palestinian farmers throughout occupied territory continue to be attacked. Palestinians with Israeli citizenships within 1948 Palestine continue to be attacked and harassed. And almost weekly, Palestinian children get run down by settlers, deliberately run down. All that is perceived as calm because we are invisible, not just to the Jewish Israeli society, but to others around the world who hold Israel up as a beacon of liberal democracy. And all this means that the racism is connected. When you have images that dehumanize people, those images get connected to real-world violence. The image that you see there of the African-American man is of an innocent man whose mugshot was taken by the U.S. Police Department, as is typical, but innocent, and whose mugshot was used as target practice. What does it mean when your picture gets used as target practice? And how much is it related and connected that African Americans' photos are used as target practice to the fact that every 28 hours in the United States, an African American man or boy gets killed? Every 28 hours, an African American boy or man gets killed by either the US police or some other private security. Images do allow for increased violence. It makes the racism acceptable. And it's made it so acceptable that you have statements such as this 10th grader in Israel openly saying to a journalist in Haaretz, "I am tremendously racist. I come from a racist home. If I get the chance in the army to shoot one of them, I won't think twice. I'm ready to kill someone with my hands, and it's an Arab." To openly say that without any sense of shame, that is the level of racism that the Jewish Israeli society has reached. And that is why increased declarations of violence against Palestinians become even more acceptable. And when racism reaches such a level against one community, how can it not spill over to other communities? So that same girl also said to that same journalist, "Those people have no place in our country." And she was referring here, and I quote, to the Arabs and the leftist. The Arabs and the Israeli Jewish leftist. She placed them in the same category. It is easy to spill over. We have seen that same disdain of life in that blockbuster American film, American Sniper. That same disdain of life, where US soldiers are humanized, although they are the occupier and the invader and the oppressor in the state of Iraq. But the US soldiers had names and families and fiancés and love lives and children and hopes and dreams. And the Iraqis, even the children in the film, were consistently represented as savages and evil and terrorists. And Chris Kyle, who is the American Sniper, actually said in his book, "We are fighting," and I quote, "savage, despicable evil." And then he said further, "I only wish I had killed more. I loved what I did. It was fun. I had the time of my life." This man is now regarded as a hero in popular US culture. But reality, he is a sociopath. There's no other word to someone who enjoys the killing of even children, a serial murderer and a sociopath. And to take it to the next level, what you see here are the tweets of individuals who saw American Sniper and said, "Now I really want to kill some ragheads. American Sniper makes me want to go shoot some Arabs. Nice to see a movie where the Arabs are portrayed for who they really are, vermin scum intent on destroying us." And the response to Rania Masri, a journalist, an American journalist, who simply rightly pointed out what Chris Kyle had said in his book. The response to her not congratulating the film was that she received hate mail, and the hate mail was specific, and I quote, "Let ISIS rape you. Cut her head off." And I read those comments and I was not surprised, because I have been getting such hate mail from the 90s in the United States. And I never got a hate mail that asked for violence against me. I never got a hate mail that said, "May you rot in hell." The signed hate mail that I got, signed with addresses and full names and phone numbers, were very specific. "May you be raped in front of your father." There is such a similarity between acceptable, dehumanizing racism and sexual violence. It goes hand in hand. My life does not matter, so let the patriarchal, sexist man enjoy it in the process as he dismisses it. They go hand in hand. And they go hand in hand to such an extent that in both these situations, murder becomes glorified. The lynching of African American men was glorified. Not only were their lives so dismissible that they could be lynched in public, but individuals back then took black and white photographs and distributed them as postcards. You could buy a postcard of this festival. So why were we surprised when we saw pictures coming out of Guantanamo of US soldiers posing with glee after they tortured Iraqi men? Why are we surprised when we see pictures coming out of Israel of Israeli soldiers posing with glee as they kill Palestinian children? It's a continuation of the same kind of racism, a continuation of it all. We're not surprised. And we're not surprised in a week of strength by those who came before us and taught us what it means. Last month marked the 50th anniversary of the assassination of a great leader, Malcolm X. And Malcolm said many things that I love and that have given me strength, but most particularly he said, and I quote, "We have to make the world see that the problem that we're confronted with is a problem for humanity. It's not a Negro problem. It's not an American problem. It's a problem for humanity. The problem that we are facing in Palestine, it's not a Palestinian problem. It's not a Palestinian-Israeli conflict. It's not an Arab problem. It's a problem for humanity. That's what we're facing." And Thomas Hurndall and Rachel Corey knew that. They knew when they put their bodies on the line and when they stood in real solidarity that they were not standing out of love for Palestinians. They were standing out of love for humanity. Thomas Hurndall chose solidarity. He put his body on the line. 11 years ago, as a 21-year-old, he was shot in the head by an Israeli sniper, in Gaza, while Tom was trying to defend children. That alone says so much. An Israeli sniper was trying to kill children and then chose to shoot someone in the head, seeing that he is unarmed. A week earlier, before Tom was shot, Rachel Corey, who comes from Seattle, Washington, in the northwestern part of the United States, was run over twice and killed by a custom-made Caterpillar Israeli bulldozer as she tried to protect a Palestinian home from being demolished yet again. Just last month, the Israeli Supreme Court ruled that the Israeli military cannot be held responsible for damages in a war zone. Just last month, the Israeli Supreme Court ruled that the Israeli military cannot be held responsible for the death of Rachel Corey. Rachel Corey's family responded in a statement and they wrote, "We have come to see through this experience how deeply all of Israel's institutions are implicated in the impunity enjoyed by the Israeli military. The decision affirming the August 2012 lower court finding amounts to judicial sanction of immunity for Israeli military forces when they commit injustices and human rights violations." I don't believe anyone was surprised by the Israeli court ruling. Just as, to be frank, I'm not surprised when another US police officer is acquitted from the shooting of an unarmed black boy deemed to be a black man, because we are always deemed to be larger because they're so scared of us. Another acquittal, none of it is surprising. We understand that the occupier, the oppressor, the one supporting a racist structure, always dismisses the lives of others to maintain their own standing. We understand this. We also understand that our deaths are not dismissible. No death is dismissible. And we fundamentally understand that their actions that stem from their fear, because racism is a consequence of fear, will not break us. They have not broken us. What keeps us together is our sense of solidarity, our sense of love, our sense of belief in our land, in our people, in ourselves. That is what is keeping us together. We understand that there are structures of violence we have to dismantle. Numerous structures of violence we have to dismantle. And as we dismantle those structures of violence, we build other structures of hope and connectivity to other struggles, because we understand the core of our struggle and we understand what it is. And we remember that because we live in such insane, hypocritical times, where war is peace, and slavery is freedom, and calm is murder, we understand when apartheid is regarded as democracy, that merely telling the truth becomes revolutionary. In time of a universal deceit, telling the truth is a revolutionary act. And here it becomes so critical, so absolutely critical, for us to know the words that we say and to be aware of them. In last summer's assault on Gaza, many people, good people, kept referring to the Gazans. And I would say there's nothing wrong with being Gazan. But 80% of the people in Gaza are not from Gaza. They're refugees from 48. So we cannot deny them that identity. And there becomes something when we refer to them as Gazans, as if Gaza is separate from Palestine. It's not. So we refer to them as Palestinians in Gaza, Palestinians in Ramallah, and Palestinians in Haifa. We use that language. And the assault on Gaza, a lot of times people from the left were saying expressions such as the death of women and children. The death of women and children. And on first count, you would say, okay, what's the problem with that? A lot of problems with that. The death of a child is the death of an individual that lacks agency, that lacks sovereignty, that lacks the ability to protect himself or herself. The death of a woman, I don't think we lack agency. Some patriarchal communities may want to impose a lack of agency on us, but by God, we have agency. So don't throw me into the same pile as children. No, because I'm a woman. I can have agency. I declare my agency. And I could also defend myself and fight. And we have a long history of Palestinian women and other women around the world who have fought. So why throw me in that category? And the second question becomes, what happens to my men if you separate me from my men? Because by simply saying women and children, then the implicit assumption is you can kill the men. Just don't kill the women and children. Because the implicit assumption then becomes that any man, any Palestinian man, must be a terrorist. Or as the New York Times claims, any Palestinian boy between the ages of 15 and 18 is a man. Thereby, because all Palestinian men are terrorists, and Palestinian boys of 15 to 18 are men, thereby we can kill Palestinian male children above the age of 15 because they are terrorists by design. They are. And if we notice the Islamophobic language that was thrown upon us in the war of terror, courtesy of George Bush Papa, George Bush Jr., all of them, Bill Clinton, Republican and Democrat, ain't much difference in the US. Gotta say that very clearly. They told us, for the love of the women of Afghanistan, we need to protect them from their men. And the only way to protect the brown women men of Afghanistan is to bomb the brown men of Afghanistan, and if the bombs happen to fall on the women, oh well, that's not our intention. There is that Islamophobic, colonialist, racist, sexist language that's used. And there's another layer there. Because our men and our women do have the right to carry weapons. They do have the right to defend themselves. Any occupied population, any oppressed population has their own right to determine their means of liberation. Whether or not we agree with them, I think is secondary to their right to determine their struggle for liberation. So when I separate the women from the men, not only am I saying you can kill the men, I'm saying that I don't salute the fighters. I'm saying that I will only mourn the civilians, and I mourn the civilians, and I mourn my children. But I mourn every single Palestinian fighter who defended Gaza, knowing it was a lost battle, and they defended it, and they defended it heroically. I mourn that. I salute that. But it also means we look at the core of the struggle when we tell the truth. And the beauty of the state of Israel right now is they're so beautifully honest. We don't have to read between the lines. That's the only difference between the Likud and the Labour Party. They both want us dead. The Likud just says so. So Peter Beinhart, who defines himself as a liberal Zionist, said, and I quote, "If we accept, for the sake of argument, that the creation of a Palestinian state, roughly among the 1967 lines," notice whenever they talk about a two-state solution, they always say roughly along the borders. Anyway, he continues, "If we accept the creation of a Palestinian state roughly among the 1967 lines, if that remains realistic and achievable, quote, then there would still be 1.5 million Palestinian citizens of Israel within Israel. And that's a prospect," he writes, "that causes considerable anxiety." He continues, "I'm not asking Israel to be utopian. I'm not asking it to allow Palestinians who were forced out or fled in 1948 to return to their homes. I'm not even asking it to allow full, equal citizenship to Arab Israelis. Since equal citizenship would require Israel no longer being a Jewish state," he writes, "I'm actually pretty willing to compromise my liberalism for Israel's security and for its status as a Jewish state." That's the core of the struggle. He's willing to compromise his liberalism to take away my rights. I don't think that's his prerogative. And he takes it even further than what Martin Luther King used to say back when the states was openly separate. He said they love the separate, the equal not so much. And here he's openly saying he doesn't love the equal. And this is the reason that the vast majority of Palestinians, because we have to recognize that the vast majority of Palestinians are not in the occupied territory, nor are they in the state of Israel. The vast majority of Palestinians are in the diaspora as refugees in Lebanon, in Jordan, in Syria, and around the world. And the reason the vast majority of us are not allowed back into our homes in 1948 is not because there's no room for us. Actually, the vast majority of our villages have been converted into green spaces. We're not allowed to go home because we're not Jewish. That's it. That's the reason open liberal Zionists want to maintain discrimination so they can maintain a Jewish state. There's a word for that. I mean, there really is a word for that. It's called ethnocracy. It's called apartheid. It's called racism. It's called discrimination. And what is so upsetting is we live in a time period now where racism is a bad word and liberal democracy is a good word. So if we openly say we don't believe in discrimination, how could the governments that espouse liberal democracy, such as the United Kingdom and the United States, so openly and unconditionally support such an open racist state? Gotta complicate that issue. And the beautiful aspect of it is that there are Israelis and Palestinians, a very small group of Israelis and a very large group of Palestinians, who are believers in liberal democracy, who have stated back in 2007
quote, "The historic land of Palestine belongs to all who live in it, including the Israelis who are living in it. And it belongs to all those who were expelled or exiled from it since 1948, regardless of religion, ethnicity, national origin, or current citizenship status." Equality. "Any system of government must be founded on the principle of equality in civil, political, social, and cultural rights for all citizens." This is what they wrote. I would argue this is what we believe in. This is what we've been taught as believers in so-called liberal democracy. This is the pathway that we struggle for. And yet, this is what we need to be stating very openly. Israel is not a liberal democracy. Israel is not a safe haven for homosexuals and lesbians as they try to present themselves. Israel is not a safe haven for women. Israel is, by definition, an ethnocracy. An ethnocracy means when you have a system of government that elevates one ethnicity, one community, above another. And that is exactly, by definition, what the state of Israel does. Particularly now that it has openly defined itself as a Jewish state. Openly. So we claim it, we name it. Resistance begins by naming the crime and naming the offender. Israel is an ethnocracy. Israel is an apartheid state. That becomes our first challenge, to recognize that we are calling for more than the end of occupation. We're calling for an end of racism. And that's the power that we have now. Because now these critical questions are actually being raised. The University of Southampton, in just a few weeks, will have an academic conference entitled International Law and the State of Israel: Legitimacy, Responsibility, and Exceptionalism. And just in case we were thinking, nah, they can't possibly be thinking what we think they're thinking, they wrote, "The conference will be the first of its kind and will constitute a groundbreaking historical event on the road towards justice and enduring peace in historic Palestine." Their words. In other words, we have an academic conference in a Western country openly questioning the legitimacy of the state of Israel. That means we are beginning to powerfully change the tide of the narrative. And once you change the narrative, you're winning. Because this is a struggle for the legitimacy of apartheid. And we declare it to be illegitimate. We declare it to be abnormal. There is a great deal of power in that. A great deal of power. And we need to remember that Benjamin Netanyahu years ago defined the threats against the state of Israel. He said, Israel is threatened by two global powers. On one hand, Hezbollah and the potential Iranian nuclear weapons. On the other hand, the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions movement that, in his words, threatens the legitimacy of the state of Israel. He's right. We do threaten the legitimacy of the state of Israel because we are opposed to racism. And to be regarded as equal in strength to Hezbollah and potential Iranian nuclear weapons? Wow, it's a good feeling. Because we are so strong, we are getting challenges left, right, and center. And my father always used to tell me whenever I'd come home organizing, he said, "Has anybody written anything about you? Anybody picked you up for interrogation? Anybody harassed you?" I say, "No." He goes, "Yeah, I guess you're not doing enough work." Because for every action, there's a reaction. And unless somebody's reacting against you, that means you're not really acting strong enough. So this could be a further example of the strength of the BDS movement. But it's another example of how connected our struggles are. So two members of the US Congress have recently introduced a bill that would turn a very destructive trade deal, which is the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, that violates national sovereignty, violates European sovereignty, violates labor unions, violates environmental laws and environmental ethics. And what they want to do is add to that a weapon against the people of Palestine and all those seeking justice against them, because this bill would force all 28 European members of the EU to crack down on European groups participating in the BDS movement. The bill would prohibit BDS campaigns and will add to the conviction that the US wants to actually use TTIP to undermine European democracy. The bill calls for surveillance and information gathering on, quote, politically motivated acts of boycott, divestment from, and sanctions against Israel. If passed, and if TTIP actually goes through, the bill would demand that the European nations return to the US Congress every 6 months with surveillance information on all individuals, organizations, and entities that participate in any way in BDS. Wow. So our struggle is not only linked to racism, it's a struggle against the encroaching surveillance that we know is increasing around us, very much so. So whether or not individuals are in support or against BDS, they need to be outraged at this, vehemently outraged at the concept of this extreme surveillance being given to the US Congress and in violation of democracy and sovereignty. And at the same time, we recognize that TTIP is more of the same Israeli policies. Because Israeli policies are basically, I like what you have, I'm going to take it. And for me to take it, I have to dismiss your life as less. Isn't that what neoliberal economic policies are all about? Isn't that what free trade economic policies are all about? I will work you to the bone, dismiss your life as irrelevant, impose modern-day slavery on you, barely give you any wages, try as much as I can to deny you the right to organize, and then have you produce something, by the way, which you don't really need, from a country that needs it more, and sell it to a population that's in debt, but encourage them to buy it. The economic structure itself needs to be altered. And it goes in hand with racism, because if we didn't so easily dismiss the lives of workers around us, there is no way we would be supporting this kind of economic structure. At the same time, you know, I've been doing anti-war work all my life, and typically the running joke was, we anti-war activists are the worst kind of people in the world because we tell you the strength and the majesty of the US global machine and all the evil that it does, and then we say, come join us. And you'd have to be drunk or insane or stoned to want to join a losing struggle. Well, this is not a losing struggle right here. BDS is a winning struggle. We are actually winning. There are multinational corporations such as Viola and G4S that have lost their contracts. They've lost their contracts. And I'll just tell you some victories just from the month of February. Just from 1 month, just some big ones. 400 UK artists have taken the pledge. The pledge is, quote, we support the Palestinian struggle for freedom, justice, and equality. In response to the call from Palestinian artists and cultural workers for a cultural boycott of Israel, we pledge to accept neither professional invitations to Israel nor funding from any institutions linked to the Israeli government until Israel complies with international law and universal principles of human rights. 400 UK artists, that's a large number. 400 UK artists that have said no to financial seductions from the Israeli government because they get paid more for crossing that picket line. 400 UK artists that may now withstand other kinds of pressure from within, you know, the music industry, that have taken a stand of solidarity and conscience. That is beautiful. And the same month, we have the largest student association in the United States, the University of California Student Association, which represents more than 238,000 students in California, passed a divestment against Israel resolution. And it passed by 9-1 vote. 9-1 vote in the University of California system. That covers 10 campuses. Spectacular. And following that, we have SOAS. Very recently, a few days ago actually, had 73% of the SOAS community, faculty, staff, and students, 73% vote for an academic boycott of Israel. So we've seen divestment, academic boycott, cultural boycott. And as if that wasn't enough, just last night, the University of Toledo in Ohio, University of Toledo, Midwestern states in Ohio, passed a resolution to divest from Israel 21-4. 21-4 in the student government. So not only have there been more divestment resolutions passed across university campuses in the UK and the US, but they're not winning by a small margin. They're winning by a landslide. That is spectacular. Absolutely spectacular. We're just checking them off, one after another. It's a landslide. There's strength from that. There's strength from looking at the connections of the struggle, from recognizing that when folks in Ferguson, Missouri were facing tear gas from made by the company in Pennsylvania that sends the same tear gas to the Israelis and the Bahrainis and numerous other people around the world, while Palestinians in Gaza, during the bombing, while they were facing the onslaught, they actually tweeted to folks they didn't know in Ferguson and told them how to respond to tear gas. And there became a connection. So consequently, the first delegation to come out of Ferguson went to Palestine. You had these youth, these African American youth, go from Missouri to Palestine as the first international delegation. They felt the connection of the struggle. They both understood what racism was. And when I tell folks in Lebanon, when I tell Palestinians that I know the story of Mike Brown, and I just don't say this is Mike Brown, and I say there was a teenager walking home, shot several times while he was unarmed and left to bleed for 4 hours in front of his grandma's home, they ask me, this was in Ramallah, this was in Gaza, this was in Haifa, where was this? I go, it was in Ferguson. We know the story. It feels like something we know. So from Ferguson to Palestine, resistance is not a crime. We've had those connections. We've had the connection recognizing that we oppose all kinds of racism committed against anyone, anywhere, by anyone, anywhere. That's what it means to connect the struggle. We acknowledge what Audre Lorde said. Amazing feminist lesbian writer, beautiful writer. She wrote, without community, there is no liberation. Without community, there is no liberation. There not only is a sense of the need to organize, therefore to liberate, but a sense to know that we need community for our own emotional sustenance. I need the community to lean against and to hold me up when I'm tired and when I'm crying. And I need to recognize that I could never be a free woman so long as there are other women enslaved by patriarchy and capitalism and military occupation. And we recognize that when we say no free woman, we also mean no free man, because we're all human beings. That's what it means when she says, without community, there is no liberation. When she said, there is no such thing as a single issue struggle, because we do not live single issue lives. So we remember, we stand in solidarity with Palestinians because we stand in solidarity with all under occupation and under oppression and resisting racism. And we do it for a whole different reason than why the Israelis and the US Police Department and the UK Police Department do it. We don't do it out of fear. We do it out of love. And we have to remember that, because when we realize that we act out of love, it gives us a whole different kind of strength, a whole different kind of power, a whole different kind of beauty. And we are doing this because truly, we love each other. And MLK said, I may not like you, but I do have to love you. But for us, I actually love the people I'm in the struggle with. So we connect our struggles. We create an honest narrative of unity, of hope. We stand together in dismantling racism, and we recognize, and I believe this, now more than ever, I fundamentally believe this. Just like when comrades before us organized for the dismantling of political apartheid in South Africa, and we're told they're imagining the impossible. They imagined it and they got it. Just when comrades before us organized against the separation in the US South between black and white, they organized and they won. But the struggle continues. We have economic apartheid in South Africa. We have ongoing racism in the United States. The struggle continues. But it's with that same
vehemence that I do believe, there will come a day when Zionism and racism will fall. The only question we are facing is how fast it will fall. And BDS is one of the paths of resistance to make that collapse of racism a little bit faster. And so we will get there. We will reach that stage. And what I hope we will achieve in the process of reaching that stage is not simply dismantling racism and not simply connecting our struggles, but actually also fundamentally dismantling capitalism. Thank you again.
To acknowledge the fact that it is in parts, and one of the things I'm definitely going to do tonight is go and hug my 10-year-old daughter, having heard those words about Palestine. So I want to say thank you. Thank you for that. But it's now time to keep good on your promise. Any questions?
Maybe we can take several questions at a time. I'll start naturally from the left.
I'm sorry, I wasn't the first man. Thank you for your speech. I'm very moving and very factual, and tried to write down as much as I could on my pen. We're in the belly of the beast. We're in the country that I feel has a historic responsibility for the problem that Palestinians are facing. And it would be good to kind of know your angle on that. Whenever I speak to Palestinians, I face Palestine, and I always look back to my Irish heritage and reject the fact that I'm British. You know, I'm sorry, but I'm Irish. You know, we're really in trouble. There's a lot in your talk that I found really interesting. You were saying at the end, you know, we need to demolish capitalism, we need to unite the struggles. Now, there's many people among the left in Britain who will say, well, there's a general election coming. There are certain political parties that may represent something different to what the Conservative Party is pursuing in relation to Palestine. And I think we have to be very careful, because the Labour Party, to me, in Britain, is one of the biggest obstacles that we have to building a real movement in this country. And in just after 1948, Golda Meir thanked the British Labour movement for what it had done in supporting the Zionist project. And this election in April, May, I think it is, people will be coming out and saying, well, this Labour MP... This Labour MP supports the boycott, divestments and sanctions movement, blah, blah, blah. What I'm trying to say is, you know, I want to support your idea of building, uniting the issues, fighting against the whole system. And to me, you know, that's a dead end. I think we need to do what Malcolm X says and build a movement on the streets.
Rania, can I be greedy and ask you two questions?
Yes, of course.
The first is that you've talked genocide for the last few years.
Yes.
And you give us the impression that there's got to be an endgame, yes, ultimately. And perhaps you can tell us whether, when that comes about as an individual, whether the West is going to stand on the side of what you have. My second question is, how do you explain that Christianity has allowed the Zionists to destroy the very cradle of Christianity and turn the whole country into an absolute abject shithole?
I want to know where the average Palestinian stands with the lack of leadership that Hamas and Fatah are playing out. Is there going to be any change? Is anybody going to do anything? Or is just going to, the cabal going to continue with those two? That's what I'd like to know.
Okay, three powerful questions. The comment on the Labour Party, I have to say, as somebody not as well versed within British internal politics, I don't feel comfortable to comment on that. But if I'm going to transform that into US politics, where we are faced between Coca-Cola and Pepsi-Cola in our elections, you know, the Democrats and the Republicans. And I truly mean that, not only because I'm left of the Democrats, but because truly, if one looks at the record, if Richard Nixon were to come back, he would be regarded as a Democrat. Okay? If FDR were to come back,
nobody would vote for. Okay, I mean, so old school Democrats have been gone. Old school Republicans are now Democrats. The U.S. has moved so dramatically to the right. So then, what do we do? Who do we elect within such a Tweedledum and Tweedledee position? And our response is the same. We mobilize from the bottom up. We get good people running for city council, good people running for mayor. And fundamentally, at least this applies in the United States, but to my limited understanding, the United Kingdom remains more of a democracy than the United States. Because the United States has been officially defined as an oligarchy. We buy our congressmen and women quite openly, you know. And to my knowledge, you don't need to be a millionaire in England to actually run for office. You cannot run for mayor in the United States without being a millionaire. So there's a whole different relationship to money and finance in the United States than I would argue there is elsewhere. But I agree with you, we need a whole movement on the ground, fundamental movement on the ground. But I also believe as an organizer that we also start with the lowest common denominator. So if I want to organize on Palestine, I may find myself also organizing with Republicans, with capitalists, with libertarians, with people from across the line on other issues, and we'd unite on this one. And then I'd turn around and organize, as I did with libertarians, on against surveillance. And in those discussions with them, when we're sitting down, I'd go, you know, do you know about this other issue? Okay, because at the bottom, at the core, I fundamentally believe that the majority of people just don't have enough information. And it's the folks at the top that actually have an agenda. But the majority of us just need to be talked to. And so we find the points of agreement and try to then build bridges across it. But if I'm only going to organize with people who agree with me fundamentally, which is what the left in the U.S. is cursed with, we used to say that give the right weapons in the States and they'll stand in a line. Give the left weapons and we stand in a circle. And as a leftist organizer, when I used to organize in the States, I found that very unfortunately to be true. So I just want to make it very clear that although I am asking for a whole new world and a whole new economic and environmental and legal system, that doesn't mean that I only organize with those who agree with me fully, because then that means I'm organizing. You know, it's a high line. I don't think that works organizationally. Your question, I'm not hopeful when it comes to the United States. I'm not hopeful when it comes to certain governments in Europe. The United States was the very last government, along with Israel, that stood against South Africa. Okay. So they would be the last to move, if they move at all. So I'm not hopeful, and if that's how we define the West, I'm not at all hopeful. I had my hopes in Greece, I still have my hopes in Greece, and my heart is breaking over what's happening now to Syriza in Greece. Whether there actually will be a transformation in Greece and then Spain and then others in Europe so that people can reclaim their own economic health and their own democratic health to be able to make positions of foreign policy remains an ongoing struggle. So that end game, as it stands right now, where although Obama is presenting himself as being hostile to Benjamin Netanyahu, Netanyahu has never had a better friend than Barack Obama. It doesn't matter if they don't like each other and they don't sit over tea. Completely irrelevant that no member of the Obama administration was present to hear Netanyahu speak in Congress. It's completely irrelevant because Obama has done more for Netanyahu than any other president before him. Obama has not even allowed the U.S. government to enforce previous U.S. policy, which just was, please don't continue to expand the settlements. Obama vetoed even such a statement. So, not expecting much to come out of the United States, and with that regard. As for the question of, you know, Christianity allowing the destruction of the cradle of Christianity, I would have to then talk about my perspective on the church. And I would argue that for the vast history of the church seems to have forgotten the teachings of Jesus. So I wouldn't be surprised that the church as an institution would stand aside and see the destruction of the cradle of Christianity because they seem to forget that Jesus was a Palestinian. It fits more with their line that, you know, Jesus was white and blue-eyed and might have come from Italy. So it fits within their construct. You know, I argue Jesus was the most famous socialist, but that's my reading of the New Testament, okay? But so that doesn't surprise me when they do that, when the church as an establishment does that. Now, there have been tidings. The Presbyterian Church is a different church in the United States and they've made powerful statements. The Quakers are a different church and they've made powerful statements. But it hasn't quite reached the establishment. As for your question about the average Palestinian, you know, I don't quite know who we are as average, but there isn't, if I'm going to try to answer it scientifically without any polling, so it's already a difficult situation. If we break it down into Palestinians living in Gaza, Palestinians living in West Bank, Palestinians living in 1948, and then the vast majority of us, Palestinians living in the diaspora, you'll find different opinions. Okay. So Palestinians in the diaspora, particularly Palestinians in Lebanon, Palestinian camps in Lebanon used to be the central organizational heart of the Palestinian movement. You would have Palestinian leaders come to the Palestinian camps in Lebanon to get their blessing to be able to start. That was altered after 83, and it's been weakened ever since. And so now they're completely dismissed and disregarded by Palestinian leadership. Hamas, Fatah, and others stand together in dismissing the Palestinian diaspora. And they dismiss the Palestinians with Israeli citizenship within 1948, and then they each tend to look into their own little enclave. So Hamas looks into Gaza, and Fatah looks into particular upper middle class individuals in Ramallah. Okay, so you've got this breakdown. Now what makes it more interesting, I argue, is when you look at who actually fought in Gaza last summer, who was fighting, real fighting, not verbal fighting. So while you had Hamas, Jabhat al-Shabi, you know, all the different Palestinian political factions, and Fatah arguing amongst themselves, the fighters within all of those parties, from Islamic Jihad to Fatah to Hamas to the PFLP, which is a leftist Marxist, you know, they fought together and they coordinated on the front. Okay, so again, how the average Palestinian looks to the leadership, generally with a great deal of disregard, and I would say with a very similar outlook that the average Arab looks to the average Arab leader. We have yet to have anywhere in the Arab world an official Arab leader that represents Arab demands. There hasn't been one. The closest one who represents only a particular community is Hassan Nasrallah, Secretary General of Hezbollah. But he only represents a particular community. He doesn't represent all Lebanese. But that's it. So they're you know, Abu Mazen, I typically never say his name without an insult, so the insult is in the air. Okay, Abu Mazen and others, they have followed the lead of other leaders before them and have, particularly Abu Mazen, been empowered by neoliberal agendas, true neoliberal economic policies that have been enforced on the Palestinian Authority since their pathetic Oslo Accords more than 20 years ago. So with the restructuring of Palestinian economy in Ramallah, that also has shifted Abu Mazen even further. You know, so you have all of these, but unfortunately, we don't have a leader that represents us anywhere. There is no real Palestinian leader that represents us, which is one of the reasons we're trying to reorganize the camps in Lebanon, trying to claim our organizational ability and go from the bottom up again. Just like we say, organize on the street, we need to organize ourselves. And there is hope because you have the mid-level who are good people. It's just the top level that we need to kind of get rid of in one way or another.
Yeah, some people will have heard me say this before, but I want to say it again because I want to know your reaction to it. Look, I'm active in the BDS movement as I was over South Africa, but I can tell you for certain it wasn't BDS that ended apartheid in South Africa. Absolutely not. The single most important factor in the defeat of apartheid was the emergence of the independent trade union movement, which culminated in the formation of the South in 1985. Everything else was secondary to that. BDS was part of the mix. It was important. It was the most important thing that we could do here, but it wasn't what brought down apartheid. Now, you know, Israel is very powerful. The Zionist machine is very powerful, and the alliance between the Americans and the Zionists is very powerful. I think it's going to take more than the BDS movement to bring it down. I also think it's going to take more than the heroic resistance that was seen in Gaza this summer to bring it down. And I wonder where you see the strategic power being. Is it in Palestine? Is it in the wider Arab world? Where does the labor movement fit into this equation?
I think my question springs from a few of the previous questions as well. So, and something you said. So I think initially I find really compelling your statement of sort of unity and struggle. And I think also it's been traditionally an issue of the left in general to unify struggles, hence the breakup. And we've had a question about how the West would react. Now my question, what's the tension of the South? Because obviously there will be a struggle against the US and many European nations, although we agree that I was wondering how